Are you considering learning to fly and getting your PPL or private pilot license? In this video, I talk about flight training, working with your flight instructor, your very first solo flight, the equipment and gear that you'll need in order to be successful, and how to pass your first aviation exam, known as a Checkride. Coming up.
963 heavy, flighting 190, maintain 10,000, runway 18 left, clear for takeoff.
If you've watched some of my other videos and they've been helpful, consider subscribing. All you need to do is hit that subscribe button and the bell notification next to it, and each time a new video comes out, you'll get notified. Let's get into it. The first thing I want to cover, like anytime you're studying a new subject, is just some basic terminology that I might be using during this video and that you'll definitely experience when you get to flight school. Most of them, if you've already done the research to get to this video, deep down in the barrels of YouTube somewhere, you've known these terms, but CFI, which is a certified flight instructor, they're going to be the ones that are generally teaching you how to fly. A demo flight, which is your first intro flight, which is just some basic thing you can get off of. Honestly, you can get that off of Groupon or any of those other places. You can go up and do an hour or half hour flight just to get a taste of flying. ATC, known as air traffic control, it's a general term that's used to when you're talking to the control tower or anybody while you're flying. That's ATC. And then a glass cockpit. A glass cockpit means a cockpit that doesn't have those round dials, which are known as steam gauges, like the old trains. A glass cockpit is what you see if you've flown on a commercial aircraft and you look in the cockpit. Generally, it's got just computer screens. That's known as a glass cockpit. Those are some basic terms that you're gonna hear, especially when you get to flight school, and I'm gonna bring them up a little bit during this video. So I just wanted to give you some quick explanation of what those words are, so we're all on the same page. The types of planes that you're gonna be flying once you get into flight school, the two most common and the ones that I honestly did the most were a Cessna 172 or 152. It's a small high wing aircraft, either a two or four seater, depending if it's a 152 or 172, or a Piper PA-28. Those are the two that I had the most flight time in. Some schools have Diamond DA-40s or other variations of that, Diamond aircraft or Cirrus aircraft. I've never flown the Diamond. I do have some time in the Cirrus just because a friend of mine had one and he was going somewhere and I needed flight time, so I jumped in for the ride and he was a flight instructor, so I logged all 8 of those hours.
As far as I'm concerned, this guy is doing it right.
Those are the four most common planes that you'll generally see as you go through flight school. Here's a mistake that some people make, is they want to go get the most expensive aircraft. They want to go get a glass cockpit because that's what jets have. The type of plane that you fly is totally irrelevant at this stage in your career, if you're planning to pursue this as a career. If you're going to buy a Cirrus and you're watching this video because you plan on getting your private pilot license so you can go fly your Cirrus around, then absolutely do your training in a Cirrus and prepare for it. If you're doing flight school as a career choice and you plan on being a commercial aviator, the hours that you build up early in your career, it's totally irrelevant what plane they are. So don't pay an extra $50 an hour to go fly a Cirrus when you can go fly a 152 or a 172 that's an older plane, because at the end of the day, when you pass your commercial check ride, your final exam, they're not gonna say, oh, well, you were flying in a 152, are you sure you can handle this? It doesn't matter, it's a totally irrelevant point. And when you go to the airlines, they're also not gonna care what aircraft you were flying in. The more money that you can save, save it. Now, if you have unlimited resources and you don't care and you wanna go fly the Cirrus, then go fly it. It's a beautiful plane. I'm just saying, you don't need to spend the money. If your budget is tight as you're going through flight school, you can save the funds. It's not gonna make any difference.
I'm cash poor.
No, I'm saying you're poor, poor.
Because if you're watching this video because you're thinking about being a commercial aviator and that's what you want to do as a career, you'll have a lot of older guys that have been doing this for a long time that will say, don't do it, it's a horrible career, you're gonna hate it, you're gonna miss your family, you're not gonna be able to spend any time around and you won't get what you want. Here's one thing that you really need to know about pilots. Pilots are whiners. We love to whine. Why do we do that? I honestly don't know. I have yet to figure it out. I was flying with a guy who had just got his dream job. A couple weeks ago, we were coming out of Hong Kong and he was saying, oh, I just got this new job and it's the dream job. I've been wanting it since I was a kid. And I was like, oh, congratulations. And then he started complaining. He's like, you know, but the thing is this base that they have, which is the new base that I'm gonna get assigned, this really sucks.
What a fucking crybaby.
I said, bro, you just got the job you said you've been working 40 years or whatever. He was about 40 years old. You've been working all that time in order to get that job. Now that you got it, you're still gonna be complaining? And he said, yeah, it's really not healthy. I just wanna let you know, in my opinion, it's an awesome job. It is a grind for sure. Coming up and getting your ratings and getting to become a commercial aviator, that is a grind. There's no doubt about it. It's better than it was 10 years ago, but I personally, I love it. I enjoy the company that I work for. I enjoy the guys that I fly with. And that's why I'm making these videos. I'm making them so I can help people who want to become professional aviators or aviators and have questions about what they want to do in their career. That's why I'm making these videos. Now your CFI, your Certified Flight Instructor, he or she is going to be someone who generally has finished their flight school and they're trying to get the hours or experience to be able to get their next job. That's generally who your CFI is going to be. They may have 500 hours or 300 hours or...
Today, Junior?
2,000 hours, I don't know. They're not always there because they really love teaching and they want to help you. That's generally not why they're there. They're there because they want to get hours and experience. Is that the best instructor you can get? No, the best instructor would be a guy who really loves to teach. That's just not how it works right now. The airlines are paying a lot, so there's a lot of guys that are just staying with those airline jobs and aren't staying as instructors. Unfortunately, that's what you're gonna have to deal with. Now, if you get a dick instructor that you do not get along with, you got two options. You can either deal with it or you can ask your flight school and say, hey, we're having a personality conflict, can I get somebody else? I had an instructor that I had one guy, and for the most part, everybody was really cool. I had one guy I just didn't get along with, and I just used him as little as possible and went with other instructors. You can try to work through your differences. You cannot, it's up to you. I've had female and male instructors. Actually, the female instructor I had for my commercial multi-engine was an amazing pilot. Maybe one of the best instructors I ever had. You're gonna have some people that you're gonna meet that are just naturally gifted pilots, and she was one of them. She was really good. All the other flight instructors would look at her because she took me up, and when I was new, to me, a 25 knot crosswind landing and the Duchess was, whoa, that was a lot, you know? And she would go up and none of the instructors would do it. And she said, this is the max demonstrated crosswind, let's go fly.
Are you joking with me right now?
I think that was more for her than it was for me because she got bored, but she was an extremely good instructor. So don't judge a book by its cover. If they're young or they're old, it's a male or female, it's totally irrelevant. When you get into your career and you're flying as a crew, you're gonna meet someone and you're gonna have to work with them. So when you get introduced to your instructor, try to make it work. If it's not working, then take it up and try to change it. Somewhere during your private pilot training, you're gonna get sent out to do your solo. Usually I'd say it's around 20 hours. I got my private pilot license while I was in Vegas. We did a couple of flights in the morning and the instructor said, okay, good, you're ready for your solo, let's go. I don't know if you've ever seen that movie in Top Gun, and if you haven't watched Top Gun, you have to watch that, really. I mean, it's almost a requirement. But one of the first scenes where they're coming in to land on the aircraft carrier and he's all over the place, that would pretty much surmise what my very first approach when I was alone was. It looked a lot like that, and it was windy. He ended up saying to come back in and land because the wind had picked up. I felt like it was horribly windy, and probably looking back on it, it was, I don't know, maybe a 10 knot crosswind or something. But anyways, it felt crazy. So there's a few things that you're gonna really realistically need. These are things that I have. You are not required to get these things. But these are the things that I've chosen. I'm not sponsored by anybody, even though if GoPro or Bose wanted to sponsor me, because I don't know, I have 20 something subscribers, maybe they want to be getting in on this action. But first thing, kneeboard. You have two different types of kneeboards that you can get. They're a little metal board that sits on your leg. There's a strap around it. You use it to write down different things that you get told or clearances you get told. There's a VFR kneeboard, which is obviously used for flying in clear weather. And then there's an IFR kneeboard. which you will not, the IFR kneeboard doesn't apply right now in the training that you're going to go to, but it's going to suit your purposes. So save your money, buy one kneeboard, buy an IFR kneeboard. I'll put a link to the one that I use in the description below. You're going to use it through all through your flight school, and if you're a flight instructor, you're going to use it then as well. So it's just a little metal board. You put a blank piece of paper on it and you write stuff down on it, clearances or whatever it is, a frequency, whatever it is they want to give you. You're just going to write it down on that paper. Get the IFR kneeboard. I'll link that. That'll save you some money on there. Headsets. So this is going to be the most expensive thing you're going to buy. You're going to have, sometimes you'll have, the school will be able to lend you a headset. Usually they have Dave Clark's. They're green, they're heavy, they clamp on your head. I personally don't like them. You know, they put out some newer ones that are better. I haven't used them. My flight instructor recommended to get the A20s, the Bose A20s. That's what I fly with now, and I may get a different newer set, but for right now I'm flying with the A20s. They're expensive. I'm not sure the exact price. I think they're roughly $1,100. I'll put a link to that as well, the ones that I use. My advice would be, buy one good pair of headsets that you can wear all the time. The noise canceling feature that you're going to have on your headset is going to, one, it's going to make being able to hear what's being said a lot more clear, and two, it's something that you'll be able to use all through flight school, while you're a flight instructor, when you go to your first job, you'll be able to use those headsets all that time. Bose is a great company. Like I said, I'm not endorsed by them, but I've never had any problems when I, you know, the earpieces started to wear out and they were within a few years of buying them. I sent them in, they sent me a brand new pair back. It was all refurbished. So they've done a great job as far as for taking care of me. And there's something you can use long-term. It's gonna be an overall better headset to have on a long-term basis. So my recommendation is buy just one good headset and be able to use that for years than have a crappy pair and then get a better pair later on. It's easier to buy one good pair. Another common pair that people get are the Zulu Lightspeeds or the Zulus. I have not used those. I can't tell you. I've heard good things about them from different people. As far as for their noise canceling, I'd say that's kind of the main competitor. I've never used them, so I can't tell you, but I'll put a link to the Bose down below. You're gonna need a E6B. It's a flight computer. It's this weird metal thing and it helps you calculate, you know, winds and things like that. You're gonna use that through flight school and then you'll never use it again. Why do you need to learn how to do it? I don't know, but the FAA or whoever's teaching you wants you to learn how to use it. So you buy it and you learn it and then you throw it away once you go to the airline. If you're doing your check rides inside the US, there's a book called the PTS Standards, Practical Test Standards book or something like that. That book is going to tell you what to expect for your private pilot check ride. It's going to go over all the things that the instructors can ask you or the examiner can ask you. So they have a set number of things that they can ask you. That book will tell you all the different things that you need to study and that are going to be in the exam. So if you read that book and you study based off of that, you already know everything that they could ask you or that they're going to talk about. So read through that and you can use that as kind of your guide as far as what you need to prepare for your flying and for your study. And then the final thing is completely optional, is getting a GoPro. Some guys like to get a GoPro so they can film their flights, they can put it on their wing, they can mount it, but down below is the one that I got. You're gonna get told to buy a lot of different books and a lot of different videos and things like that that you may not need. If you have questions about it, always in the comments below, let me know. When I get a chance, I'll respond back to you and tell you my thoughts on it if you're getting told to buy a certain book or a different manuals. But those things are what I consider as your core things that you're gonna need no matter what. So your check ride is going to be your final exam that you're going to do. You're going to have your written exam, which you'll do prior. This is going to be your flight exam. Now, I made a whole video, which I'm going to link to here. In that video, I talk about how to prepare for your check rides and how to do everything. A few quick things I want to tell you before you watch that video. I talk about limitations. Limitations, as you get deeper into your career, are going to be usually limitations will be aircraft service ceiling, how high the plane can fly, or speeds of which you can extend your gear or extend your flaps, things like that. There's not a lot of limitations at this point in your career. What you'll have is limitations as far as airspace you can fly into, who you can fly in for what type of services, things like that. When I talk about in that video, making your flashcards for how to prepare and making your flashcards for your limitations, that's what I want you to use for that section of the preparation for your exam. Other than that, I'm not really going to get into all the different rules that you're able to do once you have your private pilot license. You're going to get that from your flight instructor, and you're going to get that as you go through your ground school. But the main thing is obviously passing that checkride. So I made a whole video about that. So I'll link that wherever that goes, and I'll put it in the description below as well. All right, crew, that wraps up everything I can give you as far as preparing for your private pilot license and what to expect. In the comments below, let me know where it is you're doing your flight training. And if you have any questions or you want to know anything, leave that in the comment section below as well. I look forward to hearing from you. Until then, keep the blue side up.